matter with the clothes I'm wearing. Can't you tell that your tie's too wide? Maybe I should buy some old tab collars. Welcome back to the age of jive. All right, welcome back, Monmouth Nation. The Hawks have finally returned from their second COVID shutdown, and we are all hopeful that the rescheduled matchup with the Hofstra Pride will be taking place this Tuesday night, December 15th at 7 o'clock as rescheduled. MU fans can watch that game on ESPN3, the ESPN app. And while Monmouth has been shut down, Hofstra has been quite busy. The Pride have already played four games and are 2-2 with wins over Fairleigh Dickinson and Stony Brook and losses to Rutgers and Monmouth nemesis Iona. A lot of names there that Monmouth fans are very familiar with. And we have been made very familiar with Hofstra as well, as these two teams have now played, will have now played 4 years in a row, including Tuesday's matchup, and six times in the last nine seasons, with Hofstra winning the last three seasons matchups in a row heading into Tuesday. You might have heard my voice a lot, and generally I jump in second. Ryan is not here this afternoon, but I am very happy to be joined by Jerry Beach. Jerry Beach is a 1996 graduate of Hofstra. He's been writing about the school's athletic program since he arrived on campus back in 1993. As a student, he chronicled the record-breaking senior season of a former Jet wide receiver Wayne Corbett and the first two seasons of the men's basketball program under a fresh-faced then head coach named Jay Wright, Mr. GQ himself. He currently covers Hofstra and the CAA in general for flowhoops.com. That is FLOHoops.com. While also writing his I'll Be Quirky previews prior to every game on his Hofstra blog called Defiantly Dutch, which he began back in the fall of 2008. And whose name pays homage to the school's classic nickname, the Flying Dutchman, which I was not aware of. So I'm already learning something here. Jerry, thanks so much for coming on. Let's greet our audience.
Well, thanks for having me on here. I appreciate it, guys. Looking forward to this. Look forward to the game. Hopefully we can get it in.
All right. So Jerry will add to an already impressive list of Monmouth podcast guests. And I am very thankful to have him on to give Hawks fans a comprehensive look at this Hofstra squad. Before we get into the team breakdown, I just want to send our collective well wishes for Ryan, for myself, Marc, another Monmouth podcast host, and really just everyone collectively, all of our followers. I know that we want to wish the best to Coach Joe Mihalik, who I know has been sidelined with some health issues right now. Joe seems like not only a great coach, but just an all-around great guy from every interview segment I've seen with him and every time I've watched him coach. I do remember the Hofstra Athletics put out on Twitter 1 year. Joe was going through and kind of doing a reveal of all the non-conference games, and I knew they were playing Monmouth, so I watched, and just seems like such a genuinely great guy. Jerry, if you want to give us, you know, any feedback on that, any info, you know, or, you know, your thoughts on Coach Joe as well before we get going here.
Yeah, terrific guy, terrific coach. You know, he really, as you guys know, you know, from the MAC, you know, great work in Niagara, which is a hard place to coach and win. You know, got some great players up there. And then came down here at a time when the program was really, really scuffling. You know, they'd had a rough 2012-13. You know, a bunch of guys got arrested, and it kind of started new. And Joe said, look, we'll do this, you know, brick by brick the right way. You know, no shortcuts. You got to get great people and really good basketball players. You know, great good basketball players who are better people. And you got to get them in there and build it the right way. And, you know, we'll talk about, you know, Deion Nesmith, I'm sure. – you know, he had said, you know, that first year, guys like those guys, like Deion and Zeke Upshaw, you know, they're not going to be there for the payoff if we ever get there. But they're a big part of it. It's just, you know, and that's, you know, it was just such a methodical build, and they got the payoff last year, you know, when they won the night before everything went crazy. You know, Tuesday, March 10th was when Hofstra won the CAA, and everything started to go haywire the next night. So, you know, just, you know, and that's, it's hard to, we all know this. I mean, you guys know this. It's hard to get to the NCAA tournament as a mid-major. You can do everything right, like Monmouth did for a few years, and if it doesn't go your way in the tournament, conference tournament, you know, you know, and we know, you know, it doesn't diminish what they've done, but you want to get to the tournament. And Hofstra's able to both kind of, Joe's able to build that program and get the ultimate payoff, which, unfortunately, no one got to experience because the tournament was canceled. But, you know, terrific coach, terrific guy, and, you know, he's not with the team, not coach at the moment, but his acting head coach, Mike Fairley, has been his right-hand man since day one here at Hofstra and going back further to their days on the Agger. So it's as close, I think, as they can get to a seamless transition. And, you know, certainly everybody hopes that Joe's back sooner than later and can get the staff full again.
Thanks so much for all that, Jerry. So, yep. So let's get into it now. Let's start breaking down some of these players. And mom and fans, you know what? Cuddle up in a blanket. Get some warm tea. Maybe your favorite alcoholic beverage, because the first two names we're going to go through here, they're going to pull at your heartstrings. And poor Monmouth fans. I mean, we had our season opening preview a podcast, and I had to go through Ray Salnave leaving, and it's like I'm part podcaster and part therapist almost at this point. But here we go. We're going to start with a name that will make you cringe, Monmouth fans. 6'2" lefty senior shooter, Jalen Ray.
Yep.
He of Monmouth Hofstra lore for his game-winning three-pointer off an intentional missed free throw and tip-out back in 2017. And you know what, Monmouth fans? We're going to take you back through that.
986. Okay, we're down two. We only have one free throw. So you have to miss on purpose, right?
Yeah.
Try to get the ball. Maybe tie the game.
Work okay, math.
Miss on purpose. That never works. Kicks it out to the three for the win.
Never works.
Oh, what a play. Jalen Ray. But we got to get the dude who tipped that to Jalen Ray. That was the play of the play of the play.
Yeah, SportsCenter. Play number one. 85-84 finish. Jerry, every year we continue to play Hofstra, I keep asking Jaden Daly, Jalen Ray is still there. When
still
is
here.
He not going to leave?
Hey.
Let Hawks fans know what to expect from Ray, who has kind of changed his role a little bit with the graduation of former standout point guard DeShore Bowie.
Yeah. Well, I got bad news. You know, he might be there for a fifth year next year, depending on how this year turns out. And that shot, I still, you know, if it's any consolation to you guys, I can't believe that happened either. I mean, it was just, if I do it 100 times and that's the one time it worked out. Jalen, you know, he's kind of, he's hit beyond that mama shot. He's hit a bunch of big shots for Hofstra, even as he was the number three or number four guy in the rotation. He was just a guy who just, you know, even the other night they were playing Stony Brook and he was scuffling. I think he was 2 for 10. Just wasn't shooting very well, and with about 4 minutes left, they were in a real slump, and Coach Fairley said, you know, looked at him and said, your time, and Ray said, I know, and he hit like two big shots to put away the game. So he's a guy who I think he was my pick this year as their best player, and the player most likely from that team to contend for player of the year honors, because I just think, you know, he's ready to take that next step. The first four games have been a little different than I expected, though, because as we'll talk about in a few minutes, Tariq Coburn has kind of come on as their number one option, and Jalen is kind of still the big shot guy, but also playing some point as Hofstra tries to figure out who's going to play there with DeShore Bowie graduated, who was by the way, just for the record, the guy who really was there. You know, you wonder when's he going to graduate? That was the guy. He played 140 games, I think, and because he got hurt in 8 games into his second year, sophomore year, so he redshirted, came back for the opening night of the next year and played the next 3 seasons. So anyway, so Jalen can break his record. So Yes, yeah, so Jalen's done a lot of. He had a game, I think, against I think it's Charlie Dickinson, where he had 9 assists. He never had more than 5 in a game before that, and he's bringing the ball up a little bit, playing the point a little bit. Now the last two games, Caleb Burgess, a sophomore, I think has an assist to turnover ratio of 13-1, and grabbed the starting point guard job, which he'd been competing with Shondarius Cowart. Who is now in the transfer portal? That tells you how quickly that competition ended. So they were splitting the duty the first two games. Caleb kind of grabbed it the last two, and now he's the guy. So I'm curious to see. I think we'll see Jalen as more traditional shooting guard starting Tuesday night, given how well Caleb has played a point guard. But he's certainly shown that he's able to handle the point guard duties and break the press. He's the older player, obviously. Sure. More experience than Caleb. So, I saw a few times against Iona and Stony Brook where he was the guy responsible for carrying the ball up court, trying to break the full court press that the Gales and Seawolves were using against Hofstra. So I think by the time we see him on Tuesday night, he might be more of a more traditional role than you guys have seen him in. But sure. But he's going to be relied on to do more scoring and to be a bigger guy, be a bigger part of the equation. And it was the last couple of years where Justin Wright Foreman, Bowie, and Eli Pemberton were all the guys. He's counting on to be the guy, and I think he's going to have a pretty big year. I'd be surprised if he's not an all-conference player for Hofstra.
Well, Jerry, I'm going to vote that he plays point guard and passes all
time. It could happen. It could happen.
Next, we're going to dive into yet another Hofstra name that is going to make Monmouth fans want to crawl up into a ball and hide in a dark room. Myself included, 6'5", lefty, do-it-all, wing, forward, senior, Tariq Coburn. Now, Jerry, you might not have known this, but I'm a huge Coburn fan, going way back to his high school days at Cardozo, where he ran with previously mentioned former Monmouth Hawk, Ray Salnave. And after his transfer from St. Bonaventure, following what was a forgettable freshman campaign for him, I could be found everywhere online begging for King Rice and Company to bring him into the fold in West Long Branch. So Jerry, I want to know if you have the story on how he ended up in Hofstra and how has Coburn's role increased this year with the graduation of talented wing scorer Eli Pemberton.
I can't lie to you. I didn't know a whole lot about Coburn when he got there. I knew he sat out a year, obviously, and Hofstra's got this, they got a knack for finding guys, who might have just not, might have been, maybe St. Bonaventure was, a smidge too high for him, just like Georgia was a smidge too high for Isaac Conte. They've got a way of finding these guys who are a better fit at this level than where they were, and they take that year and utilize that year in practice and conditioning, things like that. And he had a really interesting start. To his first year here 2 years ago. He was coming off the bench, and he's an energy guy for a few weeks, and then you could just tell when they put him in the lineup at the beginning of the conference, right at the end of non-conference play, that's when Hofstra, they had that 18-game winning streak, and his insertion into the starting lineup that during that stretch really helped spark that. He's a real high energy guy, can do a little bit of everything. He can shoot the three, he'll dive for rebounds. I remember one play down there. Or down here, I should say, in Hofstra, where he dove into the, into the courtside stands to retrieve a loose ball, and kind of just, he's got that spark to him. He can do a little bit of everything, and this year, I thought Jalen would be the number one guy, and Tariq would kind of be, the 1A or 1B or number two guy, but sure. he's had a heck of a, heck of a first four games, 28 points against Iona, 17 free throws in that game. We go back to, they had, Justin Wright Foreman was going to the NBA 2 years ago. And then last year, Deshaun Bowie and Eli Pemberton were their best players. So Tariq, and Coach Fairley said this, Tariq could kind of be relied upon as the guy draining the open three, occasionally crash the board, occasionally put back finishes, but he didn't have to be, the guy. This year, and what was interesting about Tariq last year is that he was pretty consistent. He'd open up, there were games where he'd open up 5 for 5. And then go 0 for 6, or vice versa. 0 for 6, and come out of the second half and hit his first four shots. This year, you know, small sample size has been, you know, much more consistent. He's shooting 55% in his last three games. And I think it's his senior year. You know, maybe the first of two senior years, as depending on how all this turns out. And I think he's some kind of guys just know when there's more expected of them. And, you know, it was really impressive against Iona. You know, I don't know if you guys remember the name Lauren Stokes, a great Hofstra player.
Sure.
First decade of 2000s. You know, that was a guy, Tariq's much bigger than him and much broader. Lauren was really, really thin and took a beating. But man, that guy drove the lane with just ferocity every night. And that's what he looked like against Iona. You know, just driving the lane, drawing contact, hitting the line. Yeah. And, so he's kind of, you know, he's always had these individual skills, you know. But this year, it seems like he's put it all together and using all of his skills at once. And, you know, that could really open up their game and maybe allow Jalen Ray to be the guy that, you know, sinks the outside shots and opens him up to do some damage from outside. So he's had a heck of a first four games and, you know, looks like, you know, it's like, obviously it's a small sample size, but right now he looks like the guy, you know, I thought Jalen Ray was the guy who would be Hofstra's best candidate to win player of the year. Right now, I'd say that's Tariq Coburn in the CAA.
And I always believed that this could happen. I really thought from the time I saw him in high school, and he wasn't the number one star on his own high school team. That was Ray Salmave. So this guy has gone through how many years of not being, you know, always being that 1B, and now all of a sudden, you know, it's all coming together for him. And that's very dangerous when a guy's confidence goes up and up and up, because you know that anyone who's ever played any sort of sport, you always think that you could be the guy, and now he's having that chance.
Yep.
So the next man is an absolute load inside. Former Georgia Bulldog Isaac Conte is a fourth-year junior who seems as wide as he is tall. He's 6'7" and he's 240, and he's got to be one of those guys that has something like 3% body fat because it's all chiseled muscle.
Yep. Yep.
Conte absolutely blitzed Monmouth last season. He had 15 points on 7 of 9 shooting. He was just chucking guys to get his shots up inside, and he really barely played the second half in a blowout victory.
Yep.
So begrudgingly, tell us about how Conte has fared so far this year. And I know that I saw him get about 17 rebounds against Rutgers.
Yeah. He, that's, you know, another, like we were talking about Tariq, this guy, perfect, you know, perfect five guy for a CAA program. Probably was undersized to play small four at Georgia, right? But in this league, he's perfect. He's just perfect. And he's really, you know, you look at the guy, you think, okay, he's going to bang down low and, you know, beat you up down low and get rebounds. No, he can sink like a 15-foot jumper now too.
Okay.
He did that against, I think it was Stony Brook. I know he watched, like, holy smokes, look at that. He was doing that a little bit last year too, you know, 10, 12 footer. But this one, you know, dribbles out, fall away. He's a really, really good all-around player. It's funny, I just looked at the box score. I sort of forgotten how well he'd fared against you guys, because that first half of the year, and you couldn't, right? The first half of the year, you know, he was filling some really big shoes with Jaquiel Taylor, who'd had a really, really good year for Hofstra as a grad transfer from Purdue. And it was a little bit unfair to Isaac, because he's probably 20 years old last year. Taylor was 24 and played, you know, he'd been hurt a lot at Purdue, so he had to play. It wasn't like he played 140 games at Purdue, but he played, you know, 4 years at a Big Ten school that regularly beat the NCAA tournament. So he had, he had a lot to live up to. And that first half of the year, he's getting used to playing in games again. And he was, you know, and he wasn't quite understandable. You know, it's been a year and a half since you played organized basketball. And so that first, you know, three or four, you know, that Monmouth game was kind of the outlier for a while. And then once the second once the second half of the conference season kicked in, you know, he got his legs under him. And he was, you know, he was as good or better down the stretch in 19-20 than Taylor was in 18-19. So, and he's got two years to go. You know, Shaquille was a one and done.
Okay.
So,
Jerry, you're a pro's pro here, because you already got me the segue into my next question. So Ryan and I are constantly on here. We're constantly saying Monmouth needs, like, you know, a really go-to guy inside. They need to go get a guy that, you know, has some seasoning from either elsewhere, whether it be, you know, a really strong prep school or really strong high school program or, you know, a kickback transfer. And, you know, despite being a mid-major in a similar league to the MAC, I think the CAA is, you know, maybe one or two upticks higher than the MAC, depending on the year. But Coach Joe and company have always seemed to have a very talented cog at the center position, going from Conte now, who's a Georgia transfer, so an SEC-type talent, back to Jaquiel Taylor, who was a Purdue transfer, Big Ten talent, and then the guy that I like to call him the Lithuanian lumberjack, Rokas Gustis, who was another guy who was as thick as he was tall. How do they consistently attract such highly skilled and large-bodied front-court studs at Hofstra? And can you give the answer, maybe in an email, over to King Rice & Company?
I can't do that. No. Well, Rock was, you know, they're really their first big recruit. You know, they got Wanya Green and Amin Tanksley as transfers for Niagara. Sure. But in terms of four-year guys, Rock ended up being the first guy at Hofstra to play 4 years under one coach since like 2008 or something, because Charles Jenkins' senior year is Mo Casera's first year, and then Mo was only there 3 years. So anybody who played a freshman under him finished under Joe. It was crazy how long Hofstra had gone without, you know, and then Joe's first guys were the transfers. So it was crazy how long Hofstra had gone without anyone playing 4 years under the same guy. As Rock was a guy, you know, they found at a prep school in Virginia. And, you know, he was a little raw, and, you know, and quite frankly, he stayed a little raw. You know, he never quite got to the finishing off stage that Taylor got and that Conte's at. He never hit the turnaround jumper that Conte can hit or that Taylor was hitting. But, you know, just a natural, you know, nose for the ball, very Rodman-esque. He just knew where to go for the ball. He knew where to position himself for the rebound. And, you know, they got on him early, and, you know, just kind of one of those diamonds in the rough they found. And, you know, he's a guy that could have played at a higher level, but they found him, and he liked the staff, and he liked Long Island. And so they, you know, were able to hold on to him for 4 years. As for the, you know, then he graduates, and you know, they thought they need, it's funny. You always hear about baseball. You know, if you lose your ace pitcher, teams always say, oh, we'll take our 2 and 3 guys, you know, go from 12 wins to 15 wins and a 3.5 ERA, we'll be fine. That never happens. Well, it happened with Hofstra.
That doesn't happen. Take the Mets this year when they let Wheeler go, okay?
It doesn't work. Well, it actually happened with Hofstra because Joe said, you know, look, we'll need two guys to replace this one guy, right? So he went in the grad transfer market, and because he knew Conte was coming in next the following year as a redshirt sophomore. And Taylor had played at Purdue, and they also got a guy named Dan Dwyer from Pennsylvania who played. I think he made one tournament with the Quakers. And they said, all right, between these two guys, you know, let's try to get 35, 40 minutes a night from these two guys, and do what Gustis did, and it actually happened. Dwyer was a perfect 10 to 15 minute guy. Spell Jaquiel, and Jaquiel, as we were talking about in that second half of the year, just turned into an all CAA player. Mm-hmm. And actually, I'll look it up while we're talking. I looked up the
stats. While you're looking that up, Jerry, I'm going to jump in because actually Monmouth fans are pretty excited. We got a player that has a similar story to Gustis. Mm-hmm. We have a kid this year named Clemen Vuga, 6'9", 230, forward from Slovenia by way of the Virginia Episcopal prep school.
Okay.
And Monmouth fans are hoping that he could be that diamond in a rough type of deal like Rock was at Hofstra. So it'll be interesting to see, you know, obviously you never have at this level, you never have super high expectations for a raw big, but you know, those European bigs, sometimes they slip through the cracks, like you said.
Yep.
So I love that we were able to kind of have a little overlap there talking about Gustis.
Yeah.
And Clemen.
Yeah. Let's see. I'm going to tell you real quick. Dwyer and Taylor combined in 18-19 for, 10.7 points and, about 11 rebounds a game. And that's basically what Goosey's was doing, you know, 10, 11. Sure. And Goosey's the year before was, let's see.
And Ryan and I, every offseason, yell to go get a grad transfer big. So. Yep.
And Goosey's was 10.5 points and 12 rebounds.
Yep.
In 29 minutes. And these guys are kind of playing most.
Wow. You know,
yeah. And
see what happens? See what happens when you bring in grown men who are 6'8", 6'9", 6'10". And, you know, that's what I like in mid-major. I like you grow your guards, you grow your role players. But a lot of times that missing piece is that big man that has a superior athleticism, superior size, superior skill set than, you know, what you would normally see walking around to a practice in the MAC, in the CAA, you know, those type of leagues. Yeah. Now, here's a guy. And this is the last player, Monmouth fans, that we're going to, you know, go through on the Hofstra roster. This is a forward who I'm really been surprised with for Hofstra for a few reasons. 6'6", red shirt, freshman power forward, Kevon Kramer. And I read that he hadn't played organized basketball in 2 years due to recurring injuries, but he's looked really good thus far. And he's played much bigger than his listed 6'6" height, which I really question that Hofstra might have skewed that. I think maybe they put him in no socks for 6'6". He looks like a 6'7", 6'8" guy to me. Unless he's got those jumper sneakers with the big heel lift. I don't know what it is, but he plays a lot bigger. So, Jerry, I'd love for you to elaborate on what he brings and how it's really changed the look that Monmouth fans have come to know from Hofstra, primarily where that four-out, one-in outfit over the last few years with guys like Eli Pemberton playing the small ball four spot.
Yeah, he's just pure energy. And people are saying last year, because he redshirted for them last year, as you say, he's a redshirt freshman, and he would participate in pregame warm-ups and dunk the heck out of the ball. People are like, where did this guy come from? Where is he? How come this guy isn't playing for you? And, you know, they're like, don't worry, you'll see him next year. And his story is wild. He was I think a sophomore and already getting recruited by the bigs, you know, the big power fives, and blew his knee out, which, you know, is unfortunately a fairly common thing. But as he was getting ready to come back, he got a strep throat that somehow managed to, the infection managed to make its way down to his reconstructed knee and eat away at that. Oh, so man. His, you know, they said to him, you got two choices. You can either, I think it was, you can have the operation and play again as a senior, or have the operation. I may be getting some facts wrong here, but, or basically end your high school career and make sure that it really sets. And his mother said, make sure it sets. I don't want you to go through this again. And, you know, some of the bigs kind of fell off him, but Hofstra stayed with him the whole way, and he signed with them, you know, without, you know, having missed a year and change, and then he sat out last year. And, you know, he looks like he's not in the starting lineup yet, because I think they kind of want to ease him in. But he's playing more time than David Green, the freshman starter at the hole. But he's just, you know, he brings instant energy. You know, he's a really good rebounder. You've seen the dunks. You've seen the energy he brings. I think right now, you know, as a freshman, I think they think he's seeing this higher. And so let's ease him in there a little bit. And eventually, I think at some point, it's going to be hard to keep him out of the starting lineup. You know, I know he said to Josh Verlin from City of Basketball Love, I know that Mike Fairley said, you know, our goal is sixth man of the year. I'm not sure he's going to play. I'm not sure he's going to stick around that long. I'm not sure he's going to be off the bench that long, but you know, he just you know, he can finish like that, and a terrific rebounder. He doesn't get outworked underneath, and gives them, you know, a 1-2 punch that they've never had under Joe Mihalik. You know, they always had two good bigs. You know, Rokas Gustis was backed up by Hunter Sabati, and Jaquil was backed up by Danny Dwyer, but they never used at the same time. There's always one or the other. It was never four or five. Now you're seeing Kevon Kramer at the four and Isaac Conte at the five, and it's giving them a size advantage they haven't had, and a muscle down there they haven't had. So
like I said, people, size advantage, muscle, two bigs. That kid is not 6'6".
Yeah. He's 6'6" on springs. Yeah. So I suspect you'll see him off the bench on Tuesday night.
Okay.
But you'll see him play more than David Green, and you know, he's just, and, you know, he's a freshman, or a basketball freshman. He's, you know, he's gotten us a little bit of foul trouble, and his free throw shooting isn't great yet. So there's times like against Stony Brook, they took him out he committed a foul, took him out for offense because they didn't want him to shoot free throws.
Sure.
And the kid replaced him, a freshman, hit his first shot. Music.
Okay.
So it's a little. He's still, you know, a work of progress, but, you know, I think, you know, sure, I'd be surprised. This is again me talking. I'd be surprised if the kid's name was Vukasan Masik, who hit the basket. He's playing for they hadn't played since the first half, pulled him out for Kramer, vice versa.
Sure.
And he had a baseline jumper to basically put the game away. So I think you'll see a lot of Kramer off the bench on Tuesday night. I think by the time, hopefully, if there's a conference tournament season, if there's a conference tournament, hopefully there is. I think by that point, you'll see him as a starter. And
So I'll put it this way, Jerry. I've watched two of the four Hofstra games. You know, maybe not every single possession, but mm-hmm. that kid made a huge impact on me from what I saw. Yep. You know, in those two games, enough that I couldn't just give the big three. I had to put him in there, Jerry. Now I know Ray is a lefty. Coburn's a lefty. Kramer, is he a lefty too?
I think he's a righty.
Oh, okay.
I think so. Okay. I'm pretty sure. Right.
So I know that Hofstra was picked to repeat as the CAA champs. Besides the big three and Kramer, because usually when I do my write-ups, I always put like X factor guy, like who's the guy who's going to, you know, look out for as the possible X factor to swing the game that either the Pride's going to win or the Hawks are going to win. Mm-hmm. So who's that X factor guy for Hofstra this year, besides the big three? And we're putting Kramer in there with him. You know what? Hofstra says he's not a starter. He's a starter for me here. All
yeah.
right. So.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he's playing starter minutes. You know, he played 24 minutes the other night, and Green played 15. And that's, you know, he's played more minutes than him the previous three games, and has a double double too against. I think he had double double against Charlie Dickinson. So the X factor to me would be Caleb Burgess, because he's, you know, he's kind of grabbed that point guard job we talked about earlier. And, you know, 13-1 assisted turnover ratio. That's good
impressive stuff.
And half, one of those games against Iona. You know, full court press the whole game. So if he can, you know, kind of continue solidifying that spot, you know, and then, you know, that frees up Jalen Ray to, you know, be the 18-point a game guy that they want him to be, and, you know, that makes them a much deeper team. Whereas if, you know, if they're kind of mixing and matching the point and Jalen's reading the ball up a little bit, it changes the offense a little bit. If Caleb Burgess can play as well as he has the last two games, and kind of continue solidifying that position and playing really, really efficient ball, and he doesn't have to score a lot. He had a good game the other night. He had 12 points. I think it was 4 or 5 shooting, hit all his free throws. You know, a guy like that, you know, he's you know,
is he a true freshman?
He's a sophomore. He barely played last year.
Oh, okay.
He's a sophomore.
My apologies.
But they,
all right.
Right.
Yeah, so,
they lost
that's
so
what
much.
I was going to kind of harp on too, Jerry, was, you know, talking about strengths and weaknesses and this and that, and we've gone a lot into Hofstra here. I was going to say, you know, Mama's going to press and trap. We know they are. So the uncertainty, the point guard. But, hey, if Burgess can handle the load, he seems like the X factor. So here's a Mac-related question. I know our fans are going to say, hey, you know, we've learned so much about Hofstra. Can you give us something? So you saw the Rick Pitino show.
That's right. Yep.
And what do you think about this year's Iona Gale squad now as currently constructed, and what you think they could be like in March?
It's still so trippy. This is still so trippy. Rick Pitino's coaching Iona. This 2020 is just such a bonkers year. And I'll take that bonkers and the other bonkers stuff we've had. It's still so weird. Yeah. You know, they looked really good against Hofstra. They played a little hard. You know, even Mike Fairley said they played harder than us. They wanted it more. And that was a team that played, I think, Monday night. They lost Monday night, the opener to Seton Hall. They got boat raced pretty good. And, you know, this pandemic and all the weirdness going on, it's given Pitino a lot of time to work with his team. And if you work with Pitino, you're going to get better. And they were a better team on last Saturday afternoon. You know, they pressed the whole time, and Hofstra did okay with it. But you know, it was fascinating. Just, you know, this is what, you know, I'm old enough to remember when they made the Final Four in 87 with Providence. You know, the 3-point shot was a new thing, and Rick just pressed the whole game and you know, hoist chuck threes. And what they do 35 years later, they pressed all game, they chucked threes, and they hit they shot 30 threes, which was the most threes against Hofstra. And Hofstra's got a really good zone defense, and that really had limited. They had a lot more than 80 points since January 2nd, and they put up 82 on them. And they handled, this was the most threes they'd allowed in a win since the 2019 CAA title game. You know, sometimes teams chuck a lot of threes because they're down a lot.
Sure, yeah.
Like Hofstra smoked the Elon earlier last year. They saw like 35 threes because they lost.
A CAA dig. I love it.
Oh, no, nothing against Elon. But it's just like, you know, you shoot 35 threes, you lose by 20 points. That's why you shot a lot of threes. Yeah. So, you know, Iona, you know, Isaiah Ross had 33 points. And, you know, and Rick, you know, he didn't play Dylan Van Eck and Nelly Joseph as starters. He didn't want to burn their fouls against Conte. So you had Robert Brown and Dwayne Cormore, I believe, and he burned their fouls on them. And then he said, he's like, they're sacrificial lambs. And so it was, you know, Rick just, you know, he's with a one game under his belt, you tell he's, you know, he's playing the chess game and figured out a way to win. And then I thought it was really interesting. What really fascinated me about them was then they got, you know, beat pretty good by Morgan State, and Rick got really ticked off. You know, we're not a very good team right now. You know, we need a lot of help, et cetera, et cetera. And, like, you know, I'm curious to see how he handles this year in terms of that, because he's got, you know, he's been coaching the best of the best for 35 years now. And he's got really good players, Iona. I'm not diminishing that, but they're probably a notch below his Kentucky, Louisville, and Boston Celtic players.
Yeah, even what he had over in Europe, too.
Yeah. What has he got? You know, it's – okay, he's got this expectation level – for the players he's coached for 35 years or 40 years now, how is he going to adapt? And these guys are really good, but maybe not quite, you know, he can't will them to the level that he's used to playing at. How is he going to deal with, you know, he needs patience. And how's he going to do with that? And then again, they smoked Fairfield last night. So, you know, so Rick.
Yeah, I think they won by 32 points. Yeah, so I guess.
Rick got, they limited 20 points in the second half. Yeah, 42 points. Rick got ticked off, and they played great. So I'm really fascinated to see how this whole team evolves, and you know, a bunch of guys that he's trying to mold into teams to which he's accustomed, which are winning national championships. I think by March, hopefully we get to March and there's a conference tournament. Man, I wouldn't want to play a Rick Pitino coach team after 4 months in are you guys in Albany again this year? Is it Albany, right? Or is it New Jersey?
No, so Atlantic City.
Atlantic City. Okay. I wouldn't want to play a Rick Pitino coach team after 4 months in a one and done tournament, especially, you know, he's used
to be honest. I won't want to play them anywhere in March.
I know. So, I mean, you know, I haven't seen nearly enough of the Mac to make a guess, but I mean, I'd certainly expect them to be a favorite as we get down to March. And it's going to be fascinating to watch. You know, he's going to make scores out of guys. And he's going to press like crazy. They're going to be great conditioned. I mean, by March especially. You know, especially you know, most schools are out.
So, Jerry Monmouth was supposed to start with them this weekend. And I was so happy we were getting them early. And then Monmouth had the shutdown. And the Mac reworked the schedule. And now we get them the end of February.
Oh, that's not good.
it was the one thing when we were talking about the schedule in our season preview. I said, hey, we get Iona early. Like, they're only going to have a couple games in. By that time, we're getting them early before all those guys learn Pitino's system inside and out, before they all get, you know, in great shape. It's interesting. I see a lot of overlap with Ross this year and Coburn. Yep. Kind of similar players, big guards, big wings, can kind of flip between the forward and the guard. Lefties can beat you off the bounce, can knock down a three, can elevate, you know, mature bodies. I really do. So I thought that was a little interesting, to overlap Iona and Hofstra. So one last thing, Jerry, and this has been great. Thank you so much.
No problem.
We're going to go way back in time, and this will probably excite some of the old school Monmouth fans. In 2013, you name dropped him earlier, Dion Naismith. Yep. He left Monmouth, transferred to Hofstra, where he ended up playing two successful years. I was heartbroken, and this made me actually follow Hofstra hoops. So Dion's first game beyond when they played Monmouth, because I really like Dion. King Rice had been quoted as saying he's the type of guy that you want to marry your daughter.
Right.
You know, there was no hard feelings when he left Monmouth. It was just, you know, he moved on. He had started his college career as a quarterback, I think at Northeastern, actually.
Yep.
And then ended up going to Monmouth, where a childhood friend was on the Monmouth team. Then that player had left. Dion, I guess, you know, he went on to Hofstra. And Dion's first game with Hofstra also happened to be Justin Robinson's first game with Monmouth. And it was an 88-84 come-from-behind victory for the Hawks out on Long Island to open a season opener in the 13-14 season. And Robinson and classmate Josh James forced a ferocious rally to complete the comeback, setting the groundwork for what would be a monumental shift of the Monmouth Hawks program under that freshman to senior class's guidance. Can you share any memories you have of that game and of Dion Naismith's tenure with Hofstra?
I remember, you know, that was the first game for Joe Mihalik. And, you know, like I said earlier earlier in our talk, you know, Hofstra had really bottomed out the year before. You know, they I think they only won seven games, but it wasn't just that. It was, you know, they had six guys arrested, and it just, you know, it went so disastrously wrong. And I, you know, I feel really bad for Mocha Serra, the head coach, because, you know, he got, you know, he had really good intentions. He loved the program. He loved the school. And just these guys let him down. And, you know, it was heartbreaking to see him get fired, but he also understood it from the school's point of view. And so, you know, I had really, you know, I was what a friend called disengaged with the program. You know, I wasn't, you know, giving up, but I just, you know, I really liked Mo personally, and I felt bad for him, and I didn't want to, you know, be like, hey, this new guy Joe's here, and he's great, it's gonna be awesome, you know, because I didn't want to look like I was leaving, you know, forgetting Mo, because, you know, he meant well, and it didn't work out, and so I was like, all right, you know, they had a bunch of transfers, because they had no choice, they had no roster, so, and a lot of the guys that Hofstra had been let down by were transfers, so I was like, all right, that's all right. So, you know, all right, you know, let's get to the season. And I remember driving to that game with my wife, and we were actually jump back even further. I remember, you know, talking to my dad, you know, a few minutes before the opener, and like, he's like, oh, so how are they looking this year? And like, I was starting to recite facts. I picked up stuff I didn't know about, you know, you just pick up, you absorb stuff, you know, and wife and I driving to the game with our then, 1-year-old daughter and asking like, you know, who's, what number is Nesman? He's 11. Or is that Upshaw? No, Upshaw's 3. Oh, okay. And it was like, it was a really enjoyable season because they had no expectations. And you just kind of want to see, again, go back to what Joe said, you kind of want to see bricks being laid. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they had won, I think, 5 league games, finished 8th place, won a tournament game, out bracket game. That was pretty good. You'll take that for a year like that. But you could just tell, you talked about, you know, that game signifying the start of a new era at Monmouth. You could tell, you know, who knew if it would reach fruition, because it's hard to win a conference championship in the mid-majors.
Yes, it is.
But you knew that Joe was the right guy, and he found the right guys to rebuild with. And he found you know, Dion and Zeke Upshaw, who we tragically lost a couple years ago. He had a heart attack during a Grand Rapids Drive game. It had passed away. And it was – he just found the right guys. And this goes back to, you know, Joe finds guys. Zeke Upshaw scored 100 points in 4 years at Illinois State. He scored 100 points in 4 games at Hofstra and ended up with 600 points and change that year. Dion was a guy who just couldn't really find a spot at two places. Ended up being a great point guard for them in 2013-14. And then he got an extra year of eligibility. The NCAA he gave a small school a break. And he's able to come back. Yeah, I know. He was a great sixth man for Hofstra 14-15, because that was the year they got Wanya Green.
Tanksley, right? They were Tanksley, good.
Yeah. That was a team that missed out on a they almost won. Actually, Dion, a 90% free throw shooter, missed a free throw that could have iced a game in the semifinals against William & Mary, put him in the conference finals.
I said positive memories.
I know. No,
no, well, you're a glutton for punishment, just like me, playing the Jalen Ray video.
Hey, they made the conference semifinals, you know, 2 years after winning seven games. So, you could just, you know, it was like, personally as a fan, that was a game where, like, all right, you know, this is, it's good to kind of invest again. They're going to be pretty good. A new start, you know, it didn't end well last time, but you just knew, okay, you know, this is kind of going back in the right direction. And, you know, Dion, you know, and Joe said it when they won the championship in March, you know, he had said in 2014, if we get to this point where we can be up here as champions, it's going to be Zeke, Dion, Stephen Aquoni, their senior big guy. Those guys helped lay the foundation. They should be here if we get there. And then they won 6 years later, and he got a little teary-eyed and said, you know, I wish that Dion could be here, Zeke could be here, Rock could be here. A lot of Justin Reform.
Guys, I read that quote about the guys that laid the foundation.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, Dion is absolutely one of those guys. And, you know, it's that team kind of, you know, Joe finds diamonds in the rough, and Joe finds guys who, if I get a little broad here, you know, get what Hofstra is. Hofstra is a great place to kind of build yourself and maybe a little bit overlooked. And it's a great place to kind of find yourself and you know, really reach your potential. And, you know, Zeke Upshaw was on the doorstep of the NBA. And the guy barely played for 3 years at Illinois State. And they had a great year at Hofstra and, you know, was making, you know, was doing really well for himself in the G League. So,
Jerry, I do have a question going back. And I know it's 7 years ago and it probably feels like forever ago with your daughter being one at the time and, you know, Joe's first game and everything else. And if the answer is that you overlooked him, that actually kind of really paints the script. But do you remember, like, 5'8" Justin Robinson being out there? Because he was a real pest in that second half, he and Josh James.
Vaguely. I can't lie and say.
I love it.
Yeah,
I love it.
I can't lie. Josh James
was overlooked his whole life. So you were there physically in person, and I was watching on a grainy online feed at the time. But you were there in person physically, saw Justin Robinson score in double figures, be a key component of a second-half comeback in his first college game, and overlooked him and never would have thought that he would have materialized into the greatest of all time at Monmouth. It's unbelievable how these stories work out.
I know. Ken Pom has, I'm looking at the box score right now, Ken Pom has Deion Jones as the MVP of that game. So even Ken Pom overlooks Justin Robinson. Yeah. So there you go.
So if you do have your blog spot for that game, if you did do a blog about it, I would love to get my hands on that to share with the Monmouth fans as well. That would be great. Back in the archives. Do you do predictions for Hofstra games or not?
I don't usually. I'll be glad to go on the line here, though. What I usually do is I'll post the Ken Pom line, and I'll post the what the bookies might have to say. For entertainment purposes only, Yeah. It's not legal in Long Island, New York. It is legal in New Jersey, though, right?
Not on Monmouth.
Okay.
So you know what, people, if you want to do that, go to Pennsylvania. Everything's closed in Pennsylvania, though, with COVID. So if you're going there, you're just driving over there to make a bet on the game. That's it. And we are not encouraging you one way or the other. But, you know, for entertainment purposes, for the podcast, I'd love to hear it, Jerry.
That's right. I think it's a toss-up. You know, Ken Pom has it as a Monmouth by a point. I'm going to, you know, lean towards be the homer here and say, you know, Hofstra was a close one. Because these games are always close. I mean, 2 years ago, Monmouth was winless and had the ball with a chance to win it. Yeah. And for what it's worth, I think it's probably a small consolation. But that game, I thought, really triggered Hofstra's great run. Because they won, but they were mad. And you know you got a pretty good team when they're mad when they win. Because they knew that, you know, they're probably a little bit better than Monmouth. And they let them hang around. And Wright Foreman hit a big shot late. And then you guys had the ball back and missed a pretty open three at the top of the key.
I remember Ray Salnave made like a crazy reverse layup in that game down the stretch. That was a fun game. A lot of these last year notwithstanding, it's been a really fun mid-major non-conference series.
It's been fun. And it's looking like box score now. Hofstra's biggest lead in that game was 6. Mm-hmm. And Monmouth was 2. So it was a really, really well-put game. And that was the third of 18 straight wins for Hofstra. And they just turned it on after that. They were You know, you could tell they were ticked off that you know, maybe they taken Monmouth a little lightly because they're old for record. And you guys ended up making the conference finals that year, right?
Yeah, so Monmouth didn't win a game until it was either New Year's Eve or New Year's Day at the Palestra. Yep. And people were calling for King Rice's head, and it got ugly. And Ryan and I stuck by them. You know, at that point, we thought that there was more talent than what we were seeing, that they just had to gel. The former standout Micah Seaborn had left to go pro early, so they kind of didn't have that alpha guy yet. They were younger, and that was one of the most fun turnarounds we've ever been a part of. So, you know, like I said, I hope this series continues. I hope that if it does, you know, Ryan can jump on and we can have you on again. Thanks so much for coming on. It's been great.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
To hear you talk about the Hofstra players is so much better than for people to just listen to me type up some stats and my opinions. Everybody hears my opinions nonstop. So for better or for worse. So, you know, if you want to tell Monmouth fans where they can find you, your work, about your blog, you know, with you doing a blog on Hofstra Hoops, you are definitely in the true crazy fanatic category like Ryan and myself. You could just kind of have the last word here. And then if you could just wait to jump off until I'm done recording.
Sure.
Thank you so much, Jerry.
Sure. Thanks for having me on, guys. I appreciate it. I hope they play. That's all I want out of this year. I don't necessarily, you know, I like to see Hofstra win, of course, but I just want people to play and want everybody to stay healthy. And you know, I'm not 100% sure playing the season is a great idea, but it's going to happen. So I hope everyone stays healthy and they can play it and get through it. And we can get to see somebody crown a champion in March and April. My blog is defiantlydutch.blogspot.com. I used to blog a lot more before my daughter was born. You go back to the archives, I had a ton of posts, like 8, 9, 10, 11. But now I mostly just over there, I do a long pregame news and stats packet. That's a lot of fun. And I always come up with things to yell at this TV screen, the internet screen, if calls go against Hofstra. So I always look up like Monmouth alums. So there's been a Miles Austin bias in the past. King Rice flat top bias. Because by the way, I buried the lead here. I grew up a huge North Carolina fan before I went to Hofstra. I love North Carolina.
What is it with you people? You, Jaden.
Jaden, I know. Well, I don't love him anymore. Jaden still loves him. I've kind of put in the past. But I remember King Rice. I love that guy. I love this flat top. Yeah. J.R. Reed. Oh, I love those guys. I could go for an hour, but Carolina kid teams from my youth. But anyway.
just so you know, I was totally starstruck the first time I met J.R. Reed. He had played on the Knicks when I was a younger kid. Yep. And it was like, oh, my gosh. I had met him, actually. He was at a Monmouth game I went to a Thanksgiving tournament at Holy Cross where there was about 200 people combined in all the games that weekend where Monmouth was playing. And J.R. happened to be there, and I was totally starstruck. So yeah.
When I saw him across the court, I was like, holy smokes, there's J.R. Reed. I had a Sports Illustrated cover of you in my bedroom when I was in ninth grade. I'll drop a couple of Monmouth infos in there as you know, if things get, you know, good natured, you know, sure. I can't, I'll go our way type of thing. So, sure. But I'm a ton of writing as well the last couple of years at flowhoops.com, which is the CAA's online provider. If this game was a home game for Hofstra, it'd be on Flow Hoops. So I always do a weekly kind of I'll be quirky there about Hofstra, and I also do some features about the Flying Dutchman, as I call him, and the league in general. I just had a feature up yesterday about Northeastern, and I covered Patino's game at Hofstra, and kind of wasn't there. I did it remotely, but I wrote about, you know, a feature on Patino coming to Iona and kind of return home. That was fun to write. So, yeah, so fullhoops.com. I'm up there a few times a week. And then finally, dutch.blogspot.com. Check it out. Hopefully, Tuesday morning, I'll have it up before I go to bed Monday night, the Monmouth preview, and hopefully some stats and information that you guys will,
will enjoy. And Jerry will send that my way, and I'll share it with everybody who's non-Twitter on the Facebook group, and we'll get all that information out to you. And hopefully Jerry will be really upset and it's a Monmouth win. Thanks so much, Jerry. Really appreciate you coming on. And
thanks, appreciate having me.
You know what? After this game, I will continue my, I have a couple teams that I follow and cheer for when they're not playing Monmouth, and Hofstra's definitely been one of them.
Oh,
so
cool.
All the best of luck after Tuesday, and hopefully we'll get to watch that game on Tuesday.
I agree. Be safe, guys. Thanks for having me on, and hope to talk to you soon.
Thank you, Jerry. Go Hawks.